today I'll be discussing various kind of foot deformities in children. So what I see in my daily orthopedic practice is a lot of children of walking age, as soon as they start walking, the parents notice, of course, that the child is not keeping the foot the child is not keeping the feet straight, and it is either towards inside or outside. So that kind of thing worries the parents, and hence brings the child to us. So basically, the most common foot deformity that we usually get is out-toeing. Out-toeing means the toes are outside, the toes are away from midline. So the toes, the child keeps the feet outward. The other deformity is in-toeing, where the child keeps the foot inwards. So these deformities, they are obviously unsightly in appearance, and they are very comfortable. They are very uncomfortable in that sense. The child may not be able to walk as normal. As a normal child, the other deformity that we have is flat foot, where the arch of the foot is collapsed and resulting in flattening of the foot. And the other deformity, which is very common, which is a commonest deformity that happens in a newborn, is CTAV, which we call as a congenital talipes equinovarus. So we'll discuss one by one. So first of all, in-toeing is when the as already discussed, when the feet are facing inward. So basically, in-toeing is a kind of malalignment, is a part of malalignment syndrome, where the rotational deformity are present. So either it could be at the level of hip, knee, ankle or foot. So we need to see the child, we need to examine the child from hip, from waist till feet, in order to evaluate where the deformity is actually coming from. It might not be in the foot, it might be in the hip, it might be in the knee. So we need a proper thorough clinical examination. Same thing happens with the out-toeing of the foot. Normally, I want to reassure parents, is these deformity, more than 90% of deformities, they get corrected by 8 years of age, and the child, believe me, the child, it will 90% of the time, it will not require any surgical intervention. However, a constant supervision is absolutely necessary, so that the child, is seen by a qualified orthopedician, and it's so that we tend to keep a tab on the deformities that are either if they are decreasing or increasing. The next deformity is flat foot. Of course, flat foot is when your arch is flattened. Normally, we have a medial arch, which actually helps us to walk comfortably on an uneven ground. And it is normally present in everybody. So what happens is, in those children, they don't have a arch. So what I want to emphasize is, as the child is born, the arch may or may not be developed at that time, but because the child has not started walking. So till the time the child starts walking, the arch, it cannot be commented upon if a child with a collapsed arch might go into flat foot or not. So it will only be determined only after the child starts walking. So normally the child walks on the medial border of the foot. So basically, the shape is shape the foot takes place is the medial border, it touches the ground, and the lateral border is lifted off the ground. So with that appearance, the child walk, and that's what worries the parents. But the arch formation is a very dynamic process, and that usually happens till 10 years of age. So the thing is, we normally tend to educate parents, we tend to make them aware that obviously, even if the child at the age of 2 years or 3 years has a flat foot, he or she is going to develop an arch, and we will wait till 10 years. If the child is symptomatic, or if the child is complaining of pain, we can give a treatment in the form of a medial arch raise. So that usually suffices the purpose. Otherwise, I avoid giving those splints, those modified shoes in asymptomatic patients. So the as far as the flat foot is concerned, normally, even if there is no pathological abnormality like tarsal bone collisions or any other congenital condition, they will usually escape any surgical intervention. And these children, they tend to become like normal adults eventually. So the next condition, the most common condition, the most common congenital condition in the foot that we get is congenital talipes equinovarus. So that is a very obvious deformity where the feet are facing inwards and they are plantar flexed like a horse hoof. So it is a very obvious, very apparent diagnosis, and we usually get the referrals from pediatrician, from gynecologist, and mind you, it's most of the time it's an idiopathic condition. That is, we don't know why it happened. It's just the theory has been given as a packaging disorder when the child was in utero. That's how, you know, the child was keeping both the feet. So this is also a very much treatable condition. I'm talking about the idiopathic type. There are other varieties which are neurological. So these are more these go into resistant kind of varieties, and they need a prolonged treatment and may even warrant a surgical intervention very early, which unlike idiopathic CTEV. So basically what happens is it's a very apparent diagnosis. We treat them with serial casting, and then we give them splints, which obviously we tell the parents to wear 23 hours a day till the child is walking, and then we make them CTV shoes. These are special shoes with a special modification so that these deformities maintain the correction, because the problem with idiopathic CTV is not the treatment, it's the relapse, because it needs a constant and continuous monitoring and the precautions. So the because of these things that sometimes parents lose patience and they kind of become non-compliant, but then we tend to educate them on every visit that of course it needs constant supervision, so they need to frequently visit a pediatric orthopedician for that. So what I was talking about was then we tend to give them boot, and usually if there is no relapse or there is no recurrence, so these children will go on to become a normal individual and they can do everything that a normal individual can do. Thank you.